So I just want to introduce some of the elders that are going to be coming forward. So Kirk Stewart, you want to come forward. We also have Dave Delinsky and then Bruce Brumfield. And you guys can have a seat. Yeah, you can sit there. Rock can sit there. We didn't have assigned seats. Maybe we did, I don't know. So like I said, I just wanted to take a few moments. We're going to let them each take a turn discussing the ideas of encouragement, embrace, and engage, and they have a few things to share. And then obviously after the service, there's always time in between our meeting if you guys want to come forward and have a little bit more clarity. We'd be happy to speak with each and every one of you if you have time. So at this point, I believe, Kurt, you're up first. You do the short straw. And we'll be talking about encouragement.
Sorry.
Stepping right in there.
There you go.
Good morning, everyone. So nice to see you. Encouragement, before we even, you know, got into this as far as speaking today, we had talked about, you know, we had these three: encourage, embrace, and engage. And I always like to be an encourager, you know, in anything. I don't like fighting. I think it, from growing up in a household where there was a lot of conflict and fights, and I would try to make, be the peacemaker and try to make things well. And that didn't always work out, but I still try that. I don't like conflict. I like to get through things and find a solution. And man, it's not always your case to find a solution with your wife. It's a good time to listen, okay, just to throw that out there. I'm still learning that. I always want to help and, you know, find a solution. But I want to start off in prayer, okay? And one thing I want to mention as an encouragement too, I want to encourage Kathy Stellman. She had mentioned today that Tom is in rehab in California, and we want to keep him and her in our prayers and encourage them. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning, Lord, and just thank you for each one here, Lord. And as we speak your words, Lord, that they may work on all of our hearts, Lord. And just guide and lead us this morning and be an encourager to each other. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I know you can all think about a time when you've been encouraged by somebody. By a show of hands, everybody's been encouraged by someone throughout their life, right? I hope so. Okay, I'll try to keep the mic up to my mouth. Will you pass that encouragement on? I had a very good example a couple weeks ago about a passing encouragement on. Most of you know Paul Mohan, that used to be a pastor here. He brought me to Christ through prayers with him one evening, as well as many people that were praying for me years ago. Our men's Bible study for Wednesday mornings, once in a while, I'll go out and see Paul and we'll have breakfast with him. And he had mentioned to me, and when I mentioned that Dean Curtis, a former congregant here that moved to Sycamore, that Dean had had a stroke. And he had a stroke a couple months ago. He's in rehab at Marian Joy. And Pastor Mon mentioned to me, he said, Kurt, I'd really like to see Dean, because Pastor Mon had went through a stroke. And he was visited by a fireman that had went through a stroke and recovered through his stroke. And he came and encouraged Paul when Paul was going through his stroke and his rehab. And Paul wanted to pass that on. And that just stuck with me too. We should be passing on the encouragement that we've received in our lives. We've all had that encouragement, and we should share it with someone else. And that's why I think God uses these relationships we have with others, that we can learn from them and we can draw from them, draw from our relationships, draw from our circumstances, and share with others. So I took Pastor Mon and we went to see Dean Curtis, and we got into the room, and Pastor Mon says, well, Dean, I came here to encourage you through your stroke and your rehab, but I can see you're already doing better than I am. So it's kind of an encouragement to me, he said. But he's always been one to joke, and I sat there with him and Dean and laughed through an hour and a half of being with Dean. And Paul was very encouraging to Dean, and Dean was very encouraging to him and I through our conversation. And that just really spoke to me as far as what we can do in our lives. Other things that come to mind when I talked about encouragement, so many have played a role in my encouragement in my life. I look back as far as my father, my mother, my brothers, my sister, employers or employees that I've had, teachers, coaches, random people that I run into, Christians or non-Christians. It's encouragement sometimes to even speak with those people and glean things from them that the Lord says to you. And I had a gentleman from the church, I don't know if Jose is here today, but a wonderful gentleman, and met his wife and his young daughter, and he has been doing some stuff around our home, helping me out with some things, and he was a real encouragement to me through conversation with him. If you have anything to be done in your home, just he's a wonderful guy to have that help you out with pretty much anything. He shared with me that he lost two brothers recently. I believe it was May 2nd. I don't think I wrote down the, I did write down the days, the dates. On May 3rd, he lost a brother, Marcos. On May 12th, he lost another brother, Francisco, Javier. And he wanted us to just lift him up, you know, and in prayer in his family and strengthen them. And when he comes to mind, Jose for you, Jose Delgado, just pray for him to be strengthened through this time. It's bad enough to lose one brother, let alone two, and that struggle. And his mind and his actions to still be positive and encouraging. So we all go through things, and we can make a choice how we handle those things. And we can look to God, or we can just, sometimes it feels good to carry things. I don't know why, but sometimes it seems like people carry things and they just don't let go of them, or don't look to God to let go of them and look for his strength and encouragement. And that's where I want to say you want to be encouraged by God and go through, get through things. And when you see other ones that are working through these things, you can share those stories with them that you've gone through and your struggles that he's given you victory over. When I was early in the church, a new Christian, I had Pastor Maughan come up to me and he said, "Kurt, would you go through a study with a young couple?" And I'm thinking in my head, we need somebody to study with us as a young couple, Ruth and I, you know. I was struggling through some things, and different times in our marriage, Ruth and I went to counseling and stuff. Early in our marriage, we had a lot of things going on. Now our marriage is perfect. But you're not getting a mic, hon. You're not getting a mic. We've been married 40 years, but wow. He asked me to disciple this couple, and I said, sure. And I met with them many, many, many times, and it really discipled me more than them. And I think that's the biggest thing. When we go to help others, it takes our focus off of our problems and lets God work. And in every case in my life, whenever I've done that and worked with someone else, it's worked on me more than them. In fact, they're not together anymore. I don't know if it was my discipleship or not, but they're both happily married to others, but he never did ask me to disciple another couple after that either, so I did. Okay, all kidding aside, right? I guess I said everything there. It made me appreciate my wife and our marriage more. We still had a lot of growing to do. I had a lot of growing to do, but it took us from where we were at to other places. I have a few verses. I actually shared some of this that I was going to say with our Sunday school class last week, and it was interesting to hear some of the stories that were out there and some of the encouraging stories that were said, except for one that Rosie shared, but we won't go into that. But these are some verses that were shared, and I wanted to share them with you. Psalms 46:1, God is our refuge and our strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Deuteronomy 31:8, the Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. 1 Peter 5:7, one of my favorites, cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. These are promises from the Lord, and we can cling to those and use them every day in our lives. And the other thing I want to say is, being on the nominating committee this year, I want to just encourage everyone out there, just like Pastor Maughan coming to me and asking me as an early Christian, a young Christian, to disciple a young couple, I want to encourage everybody here. God has given you all gifts. God can do anything through you. examples in the Bible of people that didn't think they could do what God asked them to do, but they took the steps to do that, and God showed them a way. And I want to encourage everyone here, if there's somewhere in the church that you feel needed or you've been asked to participate, I'm talking to myself too, take a step. Take a step and try it. You know, get your feet wet. This is our church. This is Christ's church, and we're all members. And we all can help in many, many different ways. And I just want that to be encouraging, and hope that it is. I love you all, and I'm looking forward to seeing what Christ does through each one of you. Amen.
So, thank you, Kurt. But, so is it safe to say that for us to maybe be encouraged or to give encouragement, we have to come out of our comfort zone?
Many times, just like I'm sitting up here, somebody asked me, how you doing, Kurt? And I said, I'm always nervous whenever I go up in front of the church, and I love you all, and I know most of you, and I shouldn't be nervous at all, but I am. So if you're fighting that, let it go. I mean, just step forward, and usually God just lets the word flow from my mouth. If I had to repeat exactly what I said, it'd never happen again, because he takes over, and he just encourages me, and the words flow. There's so many times that I've talked to people that have said to me, thanks for your encouragement, and they'll say something back to me, and I'm like, wow, that sounds pretty good coming from my mouth, but it's all God, it's all the Lord, and he leads.
Good. Is there things that, as a leadership team, that we're going to be doing to encourage our congregation?
Yes, I hope so. No. That's another thing. When I stepped into this position and other times that I've served, I mean, it's you're never, I wasn't going to cry up here, and I brought a Kleenex in my pocket, but you're never, I don't think we're ever prepared ahead of time for some things that come in to us, and but the Lord makes us stronger and he makes us better through it, and that's what I feel like this term on the elder board. We've dealt with a lot of things, and we want to be encouraging and loving and strengthening to our congregation, because that's just what God wants us to do. And he is the leader of our church. Christ is the leader of our church. It's not any person here, any man here, any woman here. It is Christ, and that's who we follow. And the closer we stay to Christ, the better it is for our congregation and for our families, and I mean our family here. And that's our goal. Should be to follow Christ and walk in his footsteps and go where he leads us.
Amen. And our weakness, he is strong, right?
Amen.
Amen.
That's what we're leading. And I've been encouraged so much by our congregation. I would just encourage you that that's another aspect to encouragement, is to be willing to be humble enough to ask for encouragement. To say, hey, this is my family of believers. This is my home. And if I'm struggling with something, I'm willing to open up and say, hey, I need help, and I need help to in whatever aspects, physical or just prayer or spiritual. We went through a hard time with depression in my family, and the first time it happened, it was like, oh, hush, hush, don't tell nobody. And the second time, I was like, honey, I can't do it. Like, I need help. I need prayer. And you as a congregation rallied around my family in so many ways. It was a blessing, and it was amazing to see. And it's something that I'll never, ever try to hide again. Like, if we need help, I want prayer. My family was on the back of the bulletin prayer list for like 2 years straight. We had a record going, and I was happy to see it, you know, like, you know, whatever was going on. So thank you. Thank you as a congregation. Thank you, Kurt. So we're going to move over to Dave, and he is going to give us our vision, our statement, our core values on the word grace and how that relates to Grace Church.
Okay. As you've noticed, all of these values, they're easy to remember because they're ease, and then they have to do with community. We encourage you to be part of community and to encourage one another, but also we want to embrace community. And as I was thinking this, I thought, well, what does that word embrace mean? And so I kind of thought of some examples of how we embrace sometimes. And the first one that came to my mind of embracing was, maybe you have an aunt like this, you know, the one that you don't see very often, but when you see them, they embrace you. And I remember one of my aunts, I would see her maybe once every year or two, because we lived out in California and she lived here in the Midwest. But when you saw her, she would come and she would embrace you, and I would think, especially on times you say, oh, how you've grown, how everything is, and she's holding so tight, and I'm thinking, who is this lady? Who is this one that's squeezing the life out of me? But she would embrace one another, because embracing has to do with one another. It has to do with that community to hold one another close. And so that's one of the pictures of embrace as we talk about this that I want to keep in the back of my mind is that. But another way to embrace is I remember then when my children were young, a different sense of embracing. Ever been a place where you needed your children, you wanted them to, you didn't need them to, but for some reason we think we needed to stay close to you? So you embrace them, right? You find a way to just kind of keep an arm around them and hold them so what? So they don't go running off in every direction. You want to have them close to you, and you want them to know that there's a place to be right now, and that this is a place that you need to be. And so you're embracing them in that sense. But then the third sense of embrace that is in the back of my mind here, I don't know if any of you remember a cartoon called Cliffhanger. Did you remember Cliffhanger? He fell off the cliff a lot, right? But what did he always do? He found a branch. Every time, I don't know how, this guy went over cliff after cliff after cliff, but every time he went over a cliff, there was a branch on the way down that he could embrace, that he could hold on to. It was a safety net. It was a way he could hold on to it, and it kept him from falling. It kept him from injury and possibly even death. So when I think of embrace, I think of those three forms of embracing. But then I was thinking, what is it that we are to embrace? Our logo tells us some of it, and I want to start with one that's not right up here, and that is, first of all, when you need to embrace, we need to embrace, I need to embrace our salvation. We need to embrace our salvation. We need to hold it dearly and cling to it. We need to keep it close to us. We need to use that as a way that we don't fall. And when I say that, I'm reminded that salvation is not of works. It is of grace. It is a gift of God, but it is so real and so tangible. The first of all, as a community, we have to remember that we have been saved. That those of us who have come to Christ because of his grace, we are saved, and we embrace that. Amen. Do you embrace your salvation?
No.
You know, sometimes I have to say, I forget to embrace it in a sense that I say, well, I need to do something. You see, if I think that I have to do something to add to my salvation, I'm not embracing my salvation. I'm doing works, which salvation is to lead to works, but it's not, works are not to obtain salvation. So I need to embrace that and remember that what I have, that my future is because of what he has done. And I trust that's true for each of us in our community here, in this community of faith. So we need to embrace the salvation. But next, we need to embrace biblical teaching. You notice I'm kind of going backwards. I've been known to do that. My wife could let you know that. But biblical teaching. How do we embrace biblical teaching? Does it mean we just come and we hear a good sermon every week? We hear the sermon, but what does it mean to embrace it? What does it mean to love it? You know, I am so amazed when I read Psalms, and when I come to Psalms like 119 and other ones, which talk about a love for the Word of God. How many of you love the Word of God? Do you love His Word?
Sure.
Think of a verse you love. Can I tell you that probably most of us in this room, when we think of that, are not thinking of the verses that the psalmist were talking about. Because to the psalmist, the Word of God was what? The law. It was the Old Testament law. It was what God had commanded them. And the psalmist would say things like, your word is what? Sweet as right? And your word is thinking of the law. And we need to embrace that. We need to remember that God has given us his word. Why? He's given us his word not to hold us back. He's given us his law not to restrict us, but he has given us his law, his word, in order to set us free, to do what we were created to do. Do you believe that? You know, God's word, God's law, is not restrictive. It is freeing. It is freeing. And so we need to embrace that. We need to love it. We need to hold on to it and give it that big hug. We need to use that word and keep it close to us. What were the scriptures in the Old Testament about keeping the word close? They were supposed to what? Think of it what? When they got up in the morning? When they walked through the day? When they laid down at night? All day long, all the time, was the word of God, because that word was to be what? A lamp to our feet, a light to our path. It is to guide and direct. But it's also that word which rescues us. Aren't you glad for God's word rescuing us, keeping us safe, that holding on to that? God's word can do that. Have you ever come to that point where you didn't know what to do, but then you thought, wait a minute, God's word has given me all that I need. So we need to remember that. We need to embrace not only our salvation, but his word and his teaching. Now, one of the things, maybe I should have done, maybe I should have brought a pair of binoculars. I should have. And then I could have told Bruce, I could have said, hey, Bruce, I want you to look through the binoculars, but I want you to look through the large end. Have you ever tried that? Do you see very well if you look through the large end of the binocular? No. It's all out of focus. It's all very tiny. It's hard to see. And sometimes that's what we need to do with God's word. We need to make sure we're using God's word in the right direction. What do I mean by that? I mean that so often we are taught and we're conditioned and we want to interpret God's word through our experiences in the world. We want to look at our life and see what's going on and interpret God's word through those experiences. Well, I've been through that, so this God's word must mean this. You know what? That's looking through the wrong side of the binocular. Because we're not to interpret God's word through our world, but we're to interpret our world and our circumstances, our situation, in light of God's word. Amen? And that's a whole different perspective. It's a whole different direction. It puts the focus not on me, but on where it should be, and that is God. So we need to embrace our salvation. We need to embrace his word. We also need to embrace worship. I'm not talking about whether we do hymns or whether we do contemporary music, whether we have an organ or whether we have a guitar, whether the drums. That's not what about. So often we think of worship as being just that, revolving around music. And music is a wonderful, wonderful way to worship. But worship is so much more than that. What is worship? We are told to worship what? In spirit and truth. We are told to worship God in everything we do. Can you embrace that? The fact that everything I do, everything you do, everything we do, can worship God. In order to do that, we need to not only be hearers of the word, but what? Doers. Do what it says. Do the things that are said. And that is much easier said than done. So when I think of embrace, I think of that. And I need to remember that embracing is cherishing. It is loving. It's that anti-gravity. I need to remember that embracing is keeping the important things close. And I also need to remember that embracing is holding on to that which is fastened securely and can save me.
Well, thank you, Dave, for that. And just could you share with us, how do we see the leadership team using that? How are we embracing?
Okay, well, and that comes from different things. In the elders particularly, one of the things that we are charged to do, in fact, we see it in Acts when they appointed the deacons, when they appointed the others, was that there was to be a commitment to the teaching of God's word and to prayer. And I think that's one of the things that we need to be doing, is making sure that we are embracing that in a way that we're consistent with it. Our focus needs to be, are we providing not only the opportunity for teaching God's word, but are we teaching God's word correctly? And that's a high charge, you know? not many of you should desire to be teachers, right? Why? Because we're going to be judged more severely, right? And so we need to keep that in mind. And then prayer. I mean, that's the other thing, that they devoted themselves to the teaching of the word and to prayer. And to pray. We think, you know, have you ever heard the phrase, well, all I can do is pray. I can't do anything else but pray. Well, praise God that that's all you can do, because that's the most important. Amen? Because when we truly pray, and prayer is not just sending words up towards the ceiling, but prayer is, in a very real sense, dependence upon God and turning to Him and seeking Him. And when we do that, then we're able to move forward.
Thank you so much, Dave. All right, so last but not least, we save the best for last.
Of course. It's not over here.
I'll give him my microphone. That's fine. So Bruce has been with the church for a long time, and he's going to be going over Engage the Community with us.
You know, the first two, encourage and embrace, you know, when you think about those things, they actually deepen our relationship with the Lord. Amen? And it teaches us how to strengthen our walk in God. And so that's a commitment that we're making as a community, to say that we want to work together to deepen our relationship and to strengthen our walk in the Lord. Everybody agree with that?
Yeah.
And so we're going to do that. Engage is a little different, because Engage takes everything that we're learning and encourage and embrace, and putting it into practice. When I think of the word engage, I think of the buttons on all of our devices out there. You see that button with a circular button or whatever, it has a circle on it, it has a line, right? And when you push the button, what happens?
Power.
Power, that's right, something begins to happen. This is really kind of funny, because when I was in the military, I was a 17-year-old, they stuck me in front of this airplane, an F-106, and they said, you're going to be working on this thing. He says, we don't want any button pushers to work on our airplanes here, so keep your hands off the buttons. Anybody here a button pusher? Yeah, some of us like to do that. Even if we walk by a random button, we may push it, right? Anyway, engage the community with local, global, and partner ministries. A definition of engage is to participate or become involved in. So we're actually talking about, how do we become involved in our local area and our surrounding areas and around the world. And so I thought, maybe to better understand Gage, I'd like to look at three ascension statements that Jesus made, if we can do that, okay? And what will be kind of funny is, this is almost like me telling Awana kids, you know, we're going to repeat these verses over and over again. So we're just going to look at these three statements. One of them is found in Matthew 28, 18 and 19. The other one's found in Mark 16:15, and the third one's found in Acts 1:8. So I'll read them out, but I want to look at those statements, and I want to answer the following questions, okay? And these are probably important questions. And the first one is, why is this important? Why is it important that we engage? The second one is, what would be the outcome of engaging? And the third one would be, where should we be involved, okay? So those are three things I want to try to answer. So these three ascension statements. Now, these ascension statements are made by Jesus prior to going to heaven. And it was always kind of funny when they were done. It's like they were gazing upwards, and they say, why are you still standing here gazing upwards? You know, you're supposed to be doing what? Engaging. Okay? So anyway, here we go. Why is it important? Matthew 28, 18 through 19 says, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go. Let's say that word together, okay? Go. Let's say it.
Go.
Go. Oh, come on. We can do better than this. All right? Let's all say it.
Go.
Go. All right. Great. Therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. Mark 16:15 says, go. Let's say that.
Go.
Go. Go. All right. So that's great. Into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. Acts 1:8 says, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the world. So you might say that infers that we do what?
Go.
Go. All right. So why is this important? Why is it important to engage? Because Christ commanded us to go reach the lost. That's pretty important, isn't it? Here's the one who has all authority in heaven and earth. And he says, I want you to go on my behalf. Amen? As a community, should we do that? We should do what?
Go.
Okay, so what would be the outcome? Let's look at the same verses again and see if we can figure out what the outcome of engaging really is. Okay, here we go. Matthew 28, 18 through 19. All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples. So let's say that word. Make disciples of all nations. Baptizing them. Let's say that.
Baptizing them
to observe all that I have commanded you. Mark 16, 15 says, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel. So let's say that part.
Proclaim the gospel
to the whole creation. Acts 1, 8 says, you will be my witnesses. Let's say that word.
Witnesses.
In Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria until the end of the world. So what is the outcome supposed to be? That we are, because Christ said we are to be witnesses and to make disciples. Amen? That should be the outcome of engaging, is that we're adding to our church. You know, what's interesting is this idea of not marketing ourselves to the community. The idea, you know, one of the ideas is that if we deepen our relationship with each other, if we feel like we belong to something that's good, if we're happy here, guess what will happen? Other people will begin to do what? See that. And those people want to come because why? Because they see those things in us. Amen? And so it's important that we do these things. Okay, so the third one is this. Where should we be involved? Well, probably you know the verses by now, right? So let's go through this again. Matthew 28, 18, 19 says, all authority in heaven and earth. So let's say that.
Heaven and earth.
So, yeah, we may be doing heavenly things for the Lord, but it does kind of say that where we're supposed to be involved is where? In the earth. That's where Christ wants us to be. Has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. Mark 16, 15 says, go into all the world. Let's say that.
All
the world. Okay, that's a little hard to do, isn't it? All the world. And proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. Acts 1:8 says, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem. Let's say that.
Jerusalem.
Okay, so let me stop. We're not in Jerusalem, are we? But where would be in Jerusalem to us? Elgin, right? Right here. This, matter of fact, this neighborhood right here would be our Jerusalem. A lot of people living around here, isn't there? And it goes on to say, in all of Judea. Okay, so let's say Judea.
Judea.
So where would that be? It might be kind of like regionally around Elgin, right? Maybe this part of the state we might have an influence in. And then it says in Samaria. Let's say Samaria.
Samaria.
Now that one is a little different, okay? Because Samaria actually means that it's reaching people that aren't like us. And are there a lot of people here that aren't like us anymore? Our world is changing, isn't it? So we should be reaching people who aren't like us. That's taking us out of our comfort zone. Amen? And of course, the last one is, and to the end of the world. Let's say that, to the end of the world. So that's important. Why that is important is because Christ said we're to be involved with those we live around, those we aren't culturally like us, and wherever God gives us opportunity. So, you know, here are the three W's. Why, what, and where. But the bigger question is, how do we engage? What do we got to do to engage? You know, what does engagement look like? And so, you know, first of all, to engage, we need to understand something, first of all. And that is to recognize that we can't fulfill Christ's command in isolation or alone. We cannot sit here and go by just focusing on here. Amen? It takes a partnership. It takes a community to make something happen. But I'll give Wikipedia some, I really appreciate Wikipedia and what they say about community engagement. And so I just want to share this real fast and then I'll be finished here. It says this, for community engagement to happen, we need a dynamic relational process. So that means that we don't have a static process that's in place. That means that We don't build something and expect it to live on because we built it. Dynamic kind of says what? It says that it's living, it's changing, it's adapting to the culture and to the environment and to the things that are going on. So to do that, that dynamic relational process is something that facilitates three things. Okay, one of those three things that facilitates is community. So we've heard that already. We've seen that word in all three, right? Community. So the idea of community is that, you know, as we engage that, and I hope you feel this. Do you feel like we're a team working together to reach people for Christ? Do you really feel that? Because that's something that a dynamic relational process will develop, is this idea of team. That we're all on the same side. We're not trying to push against each other. But we all line up together and we go forward serving the Lord. A second thing that it facilitates is interaction. So an understanding that would be an ongoing communication and involvement. So there's communication and there's involvement that goes back and forth with these partners that we talk about up here, our local, global, and partner ministries. There's interaction with each other. And the third thing that it actually facilitates is exchange. And exchange is kind of like the idea of sharing ideas and opportunities with each other. And so, you know, as we engage, you know, we're hoping that we can bring, you know, I count it a blessing being a part of the missions committee, because we're actually talking about some of these things right now, about how we can engage and involve you, because that's the important part. And so that's something you can look forward to as we move forward there.
So thank you for that, Bruce. Hopefully, you guys have all kind of have an idea of what our church is leading towards. And all this, whether we're embracing, engaged, and encouraged, it all really just depends on how you feel about the Holy Spirit leading you. Because that's what it all comes back to. Without any of this, without us hearing the Holy Spirit leading us to encourage somebody that you might think is totally fine. Or hearing the Holy Spirit asking us to embrace, you know, the fact that we are saved. That, you know what, I've sinned today. I've done some bad things. But God gives us grace. And then to just embrace, to just listen to the Holy Spirit when it says to engage, when we're don't want to go out of our comfort zone. We feel like I can't get involved. I'm not good enough. Like Curtis said, I'm definitely not good enough to be a leader of our church. But who am I to tell God what he can and cannot do with me? Is how I look at it. So hopefully, as a congregation, you will just continue to pray with us. Continue to just seek the Holy Spirit in all things. And just continue to remember us in prayer as well as we go forward with all these things. So, as the music team comes forward, I'm just going to pray for everybody, for our time that we've had here, and just and we'll close with some announcements. Please just join me in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for who you are and what you've done for us, that you've sent your Son to die for our sins, that we can be with you again in heaven someday. And as we continue to just seek your will in all things, that we put our faith and our trust in you to seek others, to find opportunities to engage in our local community and our global community, that we find opportunities to encourage one another, to lift each other up, not to bring each other down, and to just embrace our spirituality and embrace the fact that we are saved, that we are your children. I pray for all the men who spoke today, and I pray for our congregation, and just as they look out to the coming week and to the future of our church, Lord, that they would just see themselves as participating and not just waiting for the leaders to do everything, but to finding opportunities for themselves to engage and embrace and